much to all of you for providing an audience. This is a really special opportunity for those of us who are graduate students to get an opportunity to lecture before a class this size. This is, I think, the third time ever in 7 years I've been able to do this, so thank you. I actually wanted to start out, I'm going to be talking about progressive rock, but I wanted to start out with an anecdote that will give you a sense of what the listener aesthetic is, or who the listener is for this style of music. So back in the day when I was 14 or 15 years old, I was riding in the car with my dad, and we pulled into the driveway. Late in the day, it was after some long night, something like this. We've been talking about something, you know, probably fairly meaningless. And all of a sudden, on the radio comes this song, The Pinnacle, from Kansas's album, The Moss. Has anybody heard this album or heard this song? I figured there might be one or two. This song goes on, it's a 9.5 minute song. We arrive in the driveway, and all of a sudden, the conversation has to stop. Everybody has to shut up. And our objective is now to sit in the car without speaking for 9.5 minutes and listen concentratedly to this song. And what I didn't know at the time, but you know, in later reflection thought about, is that yeah, we were really both of us participating in this listener aesthetic, this style of music. This is music for deep listening that relates to psychedelia in that way, but is a different kind of deep listening experience. The idea is not to, you know, provide or demonstrate or articulate some sort of drug experience, but really to listen in almost a classical kind of sense. And so I'm gonna play for you a little bit of that song. And what I'd like for you to listen for is, you know, ask yourselves, what are you hearing that seems familiar, that seems to reflect on something we've heard before? What are you hearing that sounds new? This is just about the first minute and a half of the tune.
Yeah. The music doesn't really repeat itself at all.
it doesn't repeat itself, right? Could you imagine what's going to happen next? Could anybody guess? Oh, we're going to go for us now. Is that what you would expect to happen at this point? No, right. What about the quality of the sound? Does this sound like this entire thing up until this point was improvised, kind of in the style of the Grateful Dead? Are we hearing something different? It sounds very polished, right? So already we're picking out some things that are really essential musical characteristics of progressive rock. The use of the synthesizer is a big one, and I'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. The polished, rehearsed sound, elements of virtuosity, that is musical excellence in performance. Uses of mixed meters, you know, that kind of reference more of a classical trajectory or classical influence. Now, these are some of the essential precepts of progressive rock, and what I hope that you'll notice is how much these are pulling out of the hippie aesthetic of the late 60s. The idea of the rock musician as an artist, the idea of the rock musician as producing sophisticated material, material that will provoke thought. Now again, the material is not intended to provoke thought that either re-articulates or evokes the experience of a drug trip. It's provoking a different kind of thought, but I hope that you can see that there's a trajectory there that relates to psychedelia. Also, this idea that the music is for deep listening. This is not the kind of music that you're going to hear in a club, right? Can you imagine that? How would you dance to that? This is music for sitting in a private space and thinking about it. And even as we go further and start looking at the Led Zeppelin IV album that Professor Brackett brought up, is a great pivot point because there's an added visual element to this of, you know, going through and looking at imagery that's attached to the sounds and having that be a part of this experience. So this is how this plays out in terms of some of the characteristics, the musical features that you would add. The idea that, like I said, there's an emphasis on musicality or virtuosity. This is different than improvisation, but related. The idea that the performer is excellent at his or her instrument or his or her voice. One of the ways that you'll see this manifested in some of the music I'm going to play for you is, in terms of the vocal deliveries, very expanded vocal deliveries, wide-ranging vocal deliveries. We already heard that exemplified by Robert Plant's vocal deliveries with, you know, he's got these this huge, expansive range, excellent high range, excellent low range. And also, again, the virtuosity of guitar and keyboard performance. Again, you start seeing these ambitious, thought-provoking subjects, and some of the subjects that you might come across are, for example, philosophy, spirituality, religion, politics, and then we see again some vestiges of psychedelia in terms of references to literature and references to fantasy. We're also going to look at some pieces that follow some unusual forms. Again, with the Stairway to Heaven example, you saw, one demonstration already of a form that doesn't follow one of those clear-cut cookie-cutter models that we were saying when we were talking about Tin Pan Alley. Rather, the form is very expansive. And even just looking at, you know, the way that it was panned left and right and that sort of expansive shape of it suggests something very different than an AABA or a verse chorus form. And also, once again, we're going to see a lot of blending of rock and psychedelia, elements of psychedelia moving forward, those that survived the sort of death of psychedelia at Altamont. It doesn't die completely, it carries on, but in a different way, and especially references to classicism and classical music. One of the first examples of this is going to be the British band Emerson Lake and Palmer. And to me, this is one of the most clear-cut demonstrations of a band trying to draw in very, very clear classical references and classical influence. In fact, in this 1971 album, Pictures at an Exhibition, they are essentially recreating a late 19th century Russian classical track. Has anybody heard Pictures at an Exhibition? The orchestral score? Yeah, several of you have. See if you recognize this. Thank you. concrete demonstration of classical music being evoked through a rock setting. Again, you hear, did everybody hear the synthesizer in that? Creating orchestral sounds, however, giving us a sense that this is, that rock music is classical and classic music is rock, right? I listed some of the other, Emerson, Lake, and Palmer arranged many, many tunes from the 19th and 20th century, you know, what some of us would refer to as the music canon. These are just a few of them to give a demonstration of, you know, how closely they're interacting with this repertoire.